Today, Rajesh Mukashi, Managing Director and CEO at CARE Ratings. Thank you very much for joining us today, Mr. Mukashi, on NDTV Profit. Great to have you on the channel. You know, the measures by the RBI last week to widen and deepen the corporate bond market, I would appreciate if you could set the context for our viewers and explain in simple terms exactly what the RBI has done. And then, of course, we'll focus on the huge opportunity it opens up for companies like yours.
I think the most important thing that RBI has done is that it is trying to create more liquidity. It is trying to create more players in the bond market. And we have always said that the bond market is crucial for the development of the Indian economy. Indian economy is largely has been developed on the back of the banking system as such. And it is important that the banking system is not overexposed to risk in terms of the broader context. And we need to diversify and develop the bond market. We have seen that there is excessive concentration in some cases where the banks are excessively exposed to corporates and groups as such. And eventually, if you see the development of the financial markets elsewhere in the world, we have seen that the bond markets play a very crucial role in that sense. And the RBI's policy decision the other day is a very, very crucial step towards moving towards further deepening the bond markets as such. Some of the key measures taken up by the RBI include participation by including the liquidity on the bond markets through repo transactions for corporate debt, allowing FPIs to invest directly in the bond markets, allowing increased credit enhancement for infrastructure projects as such from 20% to 50%, hedging for on the OTC derivatives exchange for certain foreign exchange exposed transactions, permitting brokers in the repo market as such. All these are several steps which the RBI has taken to further deepen the bond markets and have more liquidity in the bond markets in India.
Okay. Now, if you could take what you consider the most significant of those measures and explain them in simple terms to our viewers, just how it, ramps up liquidity and opens up a new window, in fact, when it comes to India's bond market.
See, we all know that there is hardly any trading. I mean, the trading levels in the secondary bond market are limited. And, sometimes people, mutual funds and other entities which are players in the bond market need a temporary liquidity to ride through a situation. In that situation, only G-Secs were to be used for repo transactions to generate the temporary liquidity as such. But now with the RBI permitting corporate bonds to be used for repo transactions, that gives them extra opportunity, extra source of securities to generate that liquidity. That liquidity by itself will generate more interest in the bond market, because there is, whenever you have a liquidity crunch, you can always rely on a temporary parking this bonds with the RBI or other entities and generating the liquidity. So that is a very, very big step, I would say. And allowing, brokers or other entities also to play an important role in the repo market will enhance that much liquidity, because the corporate may not be directly in a position to generate that liquidity or entity, and to that extent the brokers will facilitate that job further. And in a way, that is the kind of market making that is taking place in the bond market, which has been a long-standing demand from the bond market participants as such. And this, to my mind, is a very crucial step. Add to it, we can generate more participants in the bond market by having the FPIs, for example, coming into the market, because unless there are more players in the bond market, there is that much less progress on the bond market, there is that much less depth in the bond market. When we say that FPIs are going to be allowed in, large funds could flow into the bond markets, and that much more interest is there in the bond markets. Otherwise, the traditional investors have been insurance companies, pension funds, mutual funds. Now, their appetite is limited in the bond market to the extent of certain ratings and other restrictions that are put on them. I think from that perspective, it's a bigger call. It's a bigger progress for developing the bond market. Of course, there are other measures such as allowing the banks to issue masala bonds for the purpose of tier 1 and tier 2 capital. We all know that today the banking system is looking for further enhancing their capital, strengthening the capital by issuing tier 1 and tier 2 bonds. But again, there is a limited appetite for such bonds in India. And unless you open up the doors for the foreign investors coming in to subscribe to such kind of bonds, it will be difficult to further strengthen the capital of the banks, which is required in large quantum as such. So the masala bond, opening up that opportunity is again a very good development. And right. I am sure many of the banks will seek this opportunity to further strengthen the tier 1 and tier 2 capital.
Okay. You know, of course, it also opens up a whole new opportunity, or it really sharpens the opportunity for credit rating agencies, because as you have more companies visiting the bond market and activity in the bond market picks up, in very simple terms, they'll need to get their bonds rated, which means more work for you. Do you anticipate much more productive times ahead?
Yeah, I think developing the bond markets is a very crucial and is always good from the rating agency's perspective, because in the bond markets there is no credit analysis separately done by any investor, whereas in the loan market the banks themselves do their own credit analysis also. So, to the extent fund shifting from the loan market to the bond markets is always good from the rating perspective. And to that extent, the rating agencies will be having much more work than what it was in the past. But again, the exposure guidelines and other clarifications from the RBI again say that it is going to be a little more there is going to be some time required for some of these things to become a reality. For example, the exposure guidelines comes into play from 2019. And go up to 2021 for full implementation. So there is still a decent time window available for things to happen. It is not going to happen overnight. Many of the policy issues and other things have to be sorted out, and then only things will start happening. But in addition to this guideline, the RBI has also come out with this non-rated entities and rated entities and the risk weights, and which also came on the same day as the bond related guidelines were issued. There again, we find that the incentives for clients to stay unrated has diminished, and to that extent, there will be increased work for the rating agencies.
Yeah, so that's the next thing that I was really going to talk about. And again, I always like to just put the news out there before we get your assessment. When you're talking about unrated companies banks having exposure towards firms and NBFCs above 200 crores, if unrated, will now attract a risk weight of 150%. So basically, there is now an incentive to get rated. Have I worded that correctly?
Yeah, actually, it's bit technical in the sense that you can, if you had a rating in place and suddenly you became unrated, then you will immediately carry 100%, 150% risk weight. Earlier, the anomaly was that, if you are BB and below, you carried 150% risk weight. But if you remain unrated, you carried 100% risk weight. So it created some kind of awkward incentives for people to remain unrated. And that, in a way, did not reflect the true capital adequacy of the banking system as such. To a certain extent, I would say the capital adequacy was overstated. I think this is one development which is the RBI is trying to address to make sure that the capital adequacy is truly aligned with the risk weighting principles as stipulated by Basel II and strengthen the banking system as such. But yes, generally the incentives for remaining unrated will diminish. That means more and more companies may want to stay rated rather than stay unrated as such.
Fair enough. You talked about, the timelines and that the some of the measures announced by the RBI actually will play out over the next few years. So, anticipation over the next few months should be, much more rational. Over the next few months, in this fiscal, what do you really expect to play out?
I think the framework, some of these issues will get implemented during the year itself. of course, the RBI will have to clarify certain guidelines which can come within this year itself. So how soon they come will determine to what extent the business travels to the rating agencies as such. For example, take the case of partial credit enhancement, which was issued, the guidelines were issued sometime back itself to make to encourage somewhat lower rated entities to approach the bond markets. And for the first time last year, the RBI allowed the banks to give that partial credit enhancement as such. And now this year, the current the bond guidelines which have been issued the other day, again, the RBI said that the credit enhancement can actually move from 20% to 50%. I think we all know that our country's crucial growth depends on the infrastructure progress and removing the bottlenecks which some of these entities have been facing at this point of time. So I think I expect a good bit of the guidelines which have been issued so far to happen this year itself. But again, at what point of time during the year depends on those specific detailing guidelines or rules which will be stipulated by RBI going forward.
And we look forward to talking with you as the RBI moves ahead. Rajesh Mukashi, Managing Director and CEO at CARE Ratings, thank you very much for your time and insights here on NDTV. Great talking to you today.
Thank you.
We're going to take a break after.